Consider other possibilities only once life has led to attempt to express the inner nature of a thing is fruitless. What we perceive are effects, and a complete record of these effects ought to encompass this inner nature. We labor in vain to describe a person's character, but when we draw together his actions, his deeds, a picture of his character will emerge. Colors are the deeds of light, what it does and what it endures. Although it is true that colors and light are intimately related to one another, we must consider both as belonging to all Naru. Through them, nature in its entirety seeks to manifest itself, in this case to the sense of sight, to the eyes. Similarly, the whole of nature reveals itself to yet another sense. It speaks to other senses which lie even deeper, to known, misunderstood, and unknown senses. Thus it converses with itself and with a crew of 1,000 phenomena. No one who is observant will ever find nature dead or silent. Point 2 by italic added. 2. Scientific studies. Gerda, Ed, and Fran. Douglas Miller, New York. Sir Camp Publishers, 1988, page 158. 96 Theosophy. Gerda's statement should not be interpreted as denying the possibility of understanding the essential nature of things. It does not mean that we perceive only the effects of things while their true nature remains unknown behind these effects. Rather, it means that we should not talk about absolute nature at all. The being is not behind its manifestation, but something distinct from its manifestation. However, even the innate is so rich that it can disclose itself in other forms when appearing to other senses. We have disclosed to belong to the being in question, to become the true nature of the other senses, and not the whole being. Within our body, our eyes and ears develop as organs of perception, as senses for bodily processes. Similarly, we can develop soul and spiritual organs of perception that will open up soul and spirit worlds to us. For anyone who does not have such higher senses, these worlds are dark and silent, just as the physical world is dark and silent through being without eyes and ears. However, we relate differently to these higher senses than to our physical ones, which is a rumor fully developed and is by good mother nature without our doing anything about it. But we ourselves must work in developing our higher senses, just as nature develops our physical body so that we can. 2. Continue to see also volume 3 of Gerda's Naturalism chapter 3 and Gerda's scientific works edited and with commentary by Rudolf Steiner. Kirchner's Deutsche National Literature, Literature of the German Nation, in 5 volumes, 1884-97. Reprinted in Dornach, 1975, John 1 AE. The Three Worlds, 97. Perceive our physical surroundings and orient ourselves in them, so we must cultivate our own soul and spirit if we want to perceive the soul and spirit world. There is nothing unnatural about cultivating the higher organs that nature itself has not yet developed, because in a higher sense, everything that human beings accomplish also belongs to nature. Only those who contend that we should all stay at the level of development where nature left us could call developing these higher senses unnatural. For such people, these organs and their significance are, it is known, in Gerda's sense. Such people might as well oppose any and every kind of education for human beings, that too goes beyond the work of nature, and should also be especially free for operating on any uninformed mind. What happens to a blind person after a successful operation is very much like what happens to those who lose their higher senses in the way described in the last section of this book. The world now appears to them full of new qualities, new processes and new facts that their physical senses never revealed. We see clearly that there is nothing arbitrary or capricious about supplementing reality through these higher organs, and that without these organs the essential part of this reality would have remained hidden from them. The soul and spirit worlds are not, next to, or, outside, the physical world, not separated from it in space. The formerly dark world is suddenly radiant with light and color for a person born blind who has undergone an operation. Similarly, the soul and spiritual qualities of things that until now had appeared to us only in a purely physical way. 98 Theosophy. Are revealed when we are awakened in soul and spirit. Of course, this new world is also full of occurrences and beings that remain totally unknown to anyone who has not undergone a soul and spiritual awakening. Later on in this book, the development of the soul and spiritual senses will be discussed in greater detail, but first the higher worlds themselves repulsive, they did not imagine that what they are to perceive is a highly refined version of something physical. That they make this assumption usually means that they do not want to recognize what is really involved. They find it unreal, do not accept it as something that could satisfy them, and so on. True, the higher levels of spiritual development are difficult to reach, but the levels adequate for recognizing the nature of the spiritual world, and that is already a lot. Supreme Rose 99. Not be nearly as difficult to reach if people would first get rid of the prejudice that makes them imagine that what is of the soul and spiritual nature is simply a more refined version of what is physical. We obviously do not really know a person if we have only an idea of his or her physical appearance, nor do we really know the world around us if we know only what our physical senses can tell us about it. A photograph becomes intelligible and full of life to us once we come to know the person in the photograph so well that we know his or her soul. And in the same way, we can really understand the material world only once we know its soul and spiritual basis. That is why it is good to talk first about the higher worlds of soul and spirit, and only then come to conclusions about the physical world from a spiritual scientific point of view. Certain difficulties are involved in talking about higher worlds at the present stage of civilization. The greatness of our age is due above all to its knowledge and mastering of the physical world. Our very words dare to stand the meaning of the physical world, and yet we believe ordinary words is our only possible way to what is familiar. This means the door wide open for misunderstanding by those feeling to trust only their outer senses, since the first lesson we express or indicated only a certain character and imagery. This, however, is why it has to be, because such images are a means of directing ourselves toward these higher worlds and fostering our eventual access to them. We will speak about the ascent to higher worlds in a later chapter in which the development of the 4, 5, 100 philosophy. Soul and spiritual organs of perception will be discussed point 3 indeed. To begin with, becoming aware of higher worlds by means of comparisons is exactly what we should be doing. Only then can we contemplate learning to see them for ourselves. 6. Just as the substances and forces that constitute and govern our stomach, heart, lungs, brain and other organs come from the material world, our soul qualities, our urges, desires, feelings, passions, wishes, sensations and so on, come from the soul world. The human soul is a member of this soul world just as the body is a part of the physical world. If we want to cite a preliminary difference between the physical and soul worlds, we can say that the latter is much finer, more mobile and more malleable than the former. Meanwhile, of course, we have to realize that we are entering a totally new world when we come to the soul world, and that when we call things coarser, fuller, finer, in this context, we are drawing comparisons between things that are actually fundamentally different. The same applies to everything we can say about the soul world when the word swallows. Physical sense opens and starts to function. After eye operation, Formation, the two basic forces are held in balance, that is, sympathy and antipathy work equally strongly. Formation Indications of this sort approach others with asserting neutrality, acting as if they were related but without especially attracting or repelling them. They do not draw any fixed boundaries between themselves and their surroundings, so to speak, and constantly allow themselves to be influenced by other formations. The three worlds 105 around them. For these reasons, they can be compared to fluid substances in the physical world. There is no space of green for ways such formations draw others toward them. The kind of activity meant here is evident, for instance, when the soul receives a sensation of color. If I have the sensation of a red color, I am receiving a stimulus from my surroundings, considering it so beautiful to begin with. Only when my mind is a red is added to the stimulus does another soul activity enter the picture. The neutral stimulus is caused by soul formation in which a balanced interaction between sympathy and antipathy is maintained. We must describe the soul substance in question as totally malleable and flowing. When it moves through soul phase, it is not self-centered like the first type. Its existence is constantly receptive to impression, and it shows a relationship to much of what comes to meet it. Flowing sensitivity is a term that might be applied to this second type. In the third type of soul formations, sympathy predominates over antipathy. Antipathy brings about self-centered self-assertion. In this case, however, it takes second place to inclination toward things in the surroundings. We can imagine a formation like this in soul space. It appears as the center of a sphere of attraction reaching out over the objects in its surroundings. An appropriate term for these particular formations is wish substantiality. This seems to be the right designation because the effect of the antipathy present in them, although it is weaker than the sympathy, is to bring the objects the formation attracts into its own sphere of influence, thus giving the sympathy in it a 106 theosophy. Fundamental note of self-seeking. This wish substantiality can be compared to airy or gaseous bodies in the physical world, since it spreads out in all directions, just as the gas naturally tries to expand on all sides. 11. 12. The higher levels of soul substance are characterized by the total withdrawal of one of the fundamental forces, namely antipathy. Only sympathy exhibits any effectiveness. It can now begin to assert itself within the parts of the soul formation so that these parts attract each other. The force of sympathy within a soul body comes to expression in what we call pleasure. Any reduction in sympathy is called displeasure. Displeasure is simply diminished pleasure, just as cold is diminished heat. Pleasure and displeasure constitute what lives in the world of feeling, in the narrower sense, within a human being. Feeling is the soul's weaving activity within itself, and what we call our comfort depends on how feelings of pleasure and displeasure mingle in our soul. A still higher level is occupied by the soul formation, so sympathy is not confined to the domain of their own lives. They, as well as the above-mentioned force levels, differ from the three lower levels in that the force of sympathy no longer has any counteractive antipathy to overcome. Only through these higher forms of soul substance can the many different soul formations unite into a common soul world. As long as any antipathy is involved, a soul formation strives toward other things for the sake of its own life, in order to strengthen and enrich itself through the other. When antipathy is silent, the other is received as revelation, as information. In soul, the three worlds 107. Space, this higher form of soul substance plays a role similar to that of light in physical space. It causes one soul formation to absorb the being and essence of others for their own sake, or, as we might also put it, lets itself be shown upon by them. Soul beings first awaken to true soul life by drawing from these higher regions. Their subdued light in the darkness opens up to the outside and starts to shine and radiate out into soul space. Their dull and sluggish inner movement, which attempts to shut itself off by means of antipathy when only the substances of the lower regions are present, is transformed into power and mobility pouring out from within. The flowing sensitivity of the second region comes into effect only on contact, when soul formations meet, in which case one flows over into the other. Actual contact is necessary here. The upper region is a free outgrain and outpouring of the fluid. It is quite justified to characterize the measure of this region as freeing out, since the sympathy developed here lurks in such a way that this expression arrives from emerging of life and turning the use of this symbol. A soul formation without the enlivening soul substances is a higher region to be something like a plant in a dark cellar. Active soul power and soul light itself, in the narrower sense, belong to these regions and from here impart themselves to the soul being. We must thus distinguish three lower and three upper regions of the soul world and the force that mediates between them, using the following subdivision of the soul world. 13. 108 Theosophy. 1. Region of Burning Desire. 2. Region of Flowing Sensitivity. 3. Region of Wishes. 4. Region of Pleasure and Displeasure. 5. Region of Soul Light. 6. Region of Active Soul Power. 7. Region of Soul Light. 14. 15. In the first three regions, soul formations receive their characteristic qualities from the interrelationship between antipathy and sympathy. In the fourth, sympathy moves and works within a soul formation itself. In the three highest regions, the force of sympathy becomes ever freer. The soul substances of these highest regions